This is Jack Foley, and this is my second show in celebration of the late Michael McClure. I want to begin with a quotation from the poet Frank O'Hara in a piece he wrote in 1959 about the artist Jackson Pollock. "Few artists," wrote O'Hara, "are capable of sustaining more than one truth in the span of their activity. And if they are capable, they often are met with the accusation of no coherent unifying style rather than a celebration. Such criticism is panoramic and nonspecific. It tends to sum up, not divulge. This is a very useful method if the truth is one. But where there is a multiplicity of truths, it is delimiting and misleading, most often involving a preference for one truth over another." O'Hara goes on to speak of revelation through stress and conflict. I added this: "It is difficult within the framework of a short paper to do justice to work like Michael McClure's. It is so rich that every time one makes an assertion about it, one realizes that there are five or six assertions equally true, which one hasn't made. Insight doesn't cease, but begets more insight. Everything is provisional, in motion." And I quoted McClure from his book Specs: "The surge of life drifts in every direction." Though we usually think of the American 1950s as a dull, monaural moment in our history, it was precisely in the 1950s that the perception of multiplicity began to blossom, though it blossomed in the thought of outliers, gays like Frank O'Hara, beat poets like Michael McClure. The monotony of the 50s was the flip side of the coin, the disguise in which the culture began slowly to move toward the recognition of the immense multiplicity and equality of absolutely everything, and to recognize that we could see this multiplicity because we were multiplicity, that our minds were not individual, but plural entities in which supposedly contradictory elements could exist side by side. The surge of life drifts in every direction. On the day of Michael's birth, I wrote this poem, thinking of McClure on the day of his birth. "Once this was all blackness and imagination. Once this was all the big zero, the void," Sanghi says, "emptiness. Imagination took up the slack. Suddenly emptiness was filled with beings sentient and insentient, with the vastness of world upon world, all springing from the great zero, the multitudinous galaxies that surround us. Universe upon universe, and McClure there, seeing it, digging it, telling me once that he agreed with everything Garma C.C. Chang had to say. 'I'd be Buddhist,' he said, 'only I don't sit.' Then he sat. Blackness formed into a man who displayed it fully to everyone he met. 'Once,' he said, over and over again, 'this was all black plasma and imagination.'" In a review of Michael's book, Simple Eyes Feels, I wrote this: Dionysius the Areopagite writes, "The divine darkness is the inaccessible light where God dwells." Vladimir Lasky comments in The Image and Likeness of God, "If God is light, this light has neither kinship nor connaturality with the human spirit. God, by his very nature, remains transcendent, even in the imminence of his manifestation. Hence, the necessity that created being should continually pass beyond itself. Like the hero of Simple Eyes feels, like light, McClure is still in motion, still coming. The surge of light drifts in every direction. In Touching the Edge, published in 1999, he takes for the first time an explicitly Buddhist stance, producing poems described as Dharma devotions, fruits of his Buddhist meditation practice, and they are very fine. Whatever McClure writes is fiercely self-aware and full of questions, but it is very different from what language poet Stephen Paul Martin referred to as a condition of linguistic self-doubt. Language is precisely the medium in which consciousness discharges. This is from Touching the Edge. Dark paths are the way to the light in the forest, where the mountain gleams after rain and thunder. Self-knowledge flashes like sun in a downpour. Some 20 years ago, August 14th, 2000, Michael came over to my house to record the poems he had written for Plumstone's Cartoons of No Heaven. It was simply a test run. He wanted to hear how they sounded. It was not a recording meant for broadcast. My thanks to George Brooks for clearing up the sound on the tape, and to Paul Kensinger for allowing me to use his wonderful 2014 drawing of Michael in my promotional material. I played the first 7 poems on last week's show. We'll begin with number 8. Here is Michael McClure, Plumstone's Cartoons of No Heaven, from 2000.
Flow. The flowing of bodhisattvas and kalpas are all in this stream, braided, embroidered, embroidered with twigs and leaves and old cans, and the sound of the train, the Amtrak, in the heart of nowhere. New nothings of spring again. Goodbye to forever. Nada is here. Chaucer rides with his flock of horseback pilgrims, and the red-shouldered hawk, bright with himself and his striped tail, poses in the green laurel by the curb of the street. It is pleasure and pain to zoom through these realms. Walk through morning dark fog on the path, with money, keys, or beads in the hand. The sound of the stream in the dark pours into Zen. The flowing of bodhisattvas and kalpas braid in this stream. Murmuring is the mind's den, left empty, dark, and warm. Crumbling garages with a smell of straw and cedar sawdust. Winter in the shadow thrown by a yellow violet. Autumn rises from snaggles of cindered suburbs, exactly precise, shape-shifting. Stop, begin, a trillion times in each cessation, zero in each outpour. It's a body, not there, embroidered with realms, worlds, and kalpas. Like wood smoke, sifting through black steel. It's an old dog asleep in a newly cleared nook in the woods while a helicopter clatters over. She's catching her dreams. 9. Slip. To slip and to fall into blackness pushed by the pain. Black. Real black. Black no different from white. Pale blue and bright pink as the sunset behind the pine tree silhouette. To smile at the sameness, with relief to return, lying in the dark and the fog on the asphalt, the black inside no different from the white jacket being born. The jacket is white and thick. Soon wrens and thrushes will sing. A mountain will fall from my shoulders, where the mind cuts through fossils. A kiss on the forehead, where the river of stars pours. Voices singing in caves are not real, nor is guitar feedback or Buddha's eyes. Move through it all while standing or lying here. There is already someone else before the sun rises and thrushes wake. Pine cones fall onto asphalt by the thick white jacket. Uncarved and whole in every fragment. Out like a light. Gone with pressing palms together in a gesture. A mudra. This fossil of everything and nothing is at rest in a pill bottle with countless others when the wrens wake up by the road's edge in the wilderness. The dark woods and the selva oscura and the light-hearted smile curl at the center where ascent and descent melt. 10. No thing. Nothing. There's nothing. Joining into bundles of skandhas on lion shares. Straight back, straight and lifting from inwards, rising from pelvis where the flame sword swings, stretching the eyes, seeing through drips of wax to the snow lion under the monkey mind. Jagged edge, melting through realms of stony ignorance, resting forever in the lightning flash. A circle of compassion draws itself on a clear-sighted fragment called enlightenment. Even Dada failed. A dark eagle swings upward from the green side of the draw above a Snoopy bobcat. Craggy boulders are a nest of sight, sound, taste, touch, smell. Nothing is there, warmed in sunlight. Joined into bundles of skandhas and bitter odor of purple sanicle near coyote scats and a broken bottle. The pattern for a 60th trillionth of a moment, lifting from inwards, rising from pelvis. No one believes this. Windows not there. Mitochondria in cells are furnace flares, unreal as imagination and chemical bonds. Links of dusky purple, touch of brick, and honey on the tongue make solid to be slashed by a wise sword, freeing worlds. 11. River. No river here but the path across it, marked with broken stones. Jade dust where catfish dream of faces and furred fins. The boat is the whole of not being there. Blinks on as clouds pass, and off. Turning the light inward is zero. Under the eyes and the bone, not there in a presence. Turning the beam toward flesh. No meat. No mind. No consciousness. No one to be free of darkness or for the light to find. Herds of clouds and rain dropping on dust, making tiny craters. A raven above the gray-black street. Absolute order. Drifting of morning fog, marbling on edges of books. The authenticity of a clock, incense smoke, candle flickers, or sports utility vans painted the color of nail polish. Nothing behind them. All lean on each other, helping. The boat is thus. thus reached for, with light turned inward. Shoulders are all put to the wheel of nothingness. Sunyata, stems of wildflowers, crane toward the moon. Some things brightly sleep already. 12. Personae, expressions, masks. These masks moved into mixed shapes. Hunger, surfeit, and rage. Mindless pleasure and envy. Slump and stressed shoulders brushing the earlobes. Greed, hatred, and ignorance. Neurons and hormones raging into gray plastic landmines and poisoned flowers for the black and red butterfly or for a sister. She stands by her red wagon of earth as all beings heave toward realms. Cushions of moss and velvet, spinning dust specks gleaming with movies when the mirror reflects a forest fire. Black eyes beyond mind. Luminous when the palms and fingers touch and the forehead bows to the listener who stands with her red wagon alert to the cries of mice and car victims. Flared as robin chirps on a frosty morning. Older than hell. Older than love. Galaxies and gametes beginning nowhere as cherry blossoms. No time. One uncarved block. One end like a candle. One more shoulder with the others turning the wheel. No blame in the swirl. 13. Each side of each dust speck turning in sunlight is a movie. Caves in the movies reach to the tiny end of infinity, and each speck grows to fill all. The sounds of behemoths trumpet in plain nothing. Ordinary, plain as a toothpick. Not sacred or born with faith, real as strep colonies in a throat. Precious, precisely interpenetrating in countless dimensions, free as the lion's smile as she purrs through the Dharma. A wren calls like a bell from the canyon, and layers of colors rise over the mountain at sunset. Motorcycles grunt from the freeway. Searching for excitement. I know this through bundles of aggregates of consciousness, sensual drippings of experience, build a stalactite with specks of floating dust in a sunrise by a river. I move from imbecility and sensibility and hope to be a broken sand grain under the shell of an oyster. 14. Bedraggled. Glamorous. Old as coyote breath. New as comme des garçons. Here. Gone. Here. Past SeaWorld Drive. Even Dada failed. Smog. Bush poppies. Mountain air. Wrestle the black river, moving white stones without fail. Legs crossed, hands in a mudra. Sweetness and cheery blandness of domestication is not the way to the eye of the Dharma. Also, outrage loses. I'm dressed in a robe of anger, sitting in an inside no different from outside. Now the sky has FedEx planes and stars and two planets, as unreal as molecules, string theory, and swathed dimensions. The robe flashes wizard moons, volcanoes, and moth jewel patches. It's better to practice seeing the mountain and the roadside culvert are present and gone. Not blown out like a candle. Not collapsed by indifference. But they stand on the same feet. Gassho to all sutras. Gassho to daydream cartoons of monkey mind. Gassho to the old scholar surrounded by cool snakes. See the landscape of industrial buildings. Is there? Not there. There. There and not there. Nearby are the footprints of mastodons and camel herds in Pleistocene earth, real and solid as a flea market. 15. Welcome, dear chaos. Welcome, light of the roar. Calm light of the roar. Sound of a feather falling in some paradise. Paradise nearby. Roar light in ordinary blackness. Transparent blackness zings out and in. Sculptured hands of a seated figure. Half-closed eyes. Plain as disturbance and straw and grandpa's tin snuff box. No light. No straw. No donkey. Even Dada failed. The sutra rests on a lotus. One hand swings the sword. Flame edges are blades chopping out walls, freeing the realms. Serious as comedy. Cartoons of no heaven. Where is a beginning or end? Tied up in strings and star cliffs? No beginning or end. Cartoons of no heaven. Straw and grandpa's snuff box. The mind in the hands knows. Here. 6 trillionths of a moment. Sometimes a brackage film projected on the skin of a tadpole. More often, wisdom disguised as compassion roaring in the four corners. The center is unutterably calm and does not seem so before birth flashes, lightning and turquoise. We sit on black cushions in the coolness.
That was Michael McClure from August 14th, 2000, in Oakland, California. Michael was reading from his then-new book, Plumstones, Cartoons of No Heaven. The book is alive with his discovery of Buddhism and his realization that even Dada failed. His mind moves back and forth between the created world and nothingness, asserting, denying. He wrote on my copy of the manuscript, "It is pleasure and pain to zoom through these realms." The book begins with a quotation from Dogen from the 13th century. "Things which are not sequential are being. Things which are not aligned are being." I want to conclude the show with some poems Michael wrote for me. And my answer. March 2nd, 2003. Travel notebook poems for Jack Foley. To be accompanied by a bust of Mickey Mouse and with apologies to a Scottish poet. I am for Jack. I am myriadness, multi-tracked, an energy packet of illuminations like Rambeau, zooming on winged boots, im ganzen, guten, wahren, resolut zu leben, through deepening consciousness, settling into patterning waves to be restirred in lappings and crashes and mouse roars and eagle eyes, snakes on highways and sunlight from solid paths, real as stone and flimsy as ghosts in the cavern ways of disbanded and banding souls. Do not count, nor does matter, or hallet with feeble fantasy, like to the leaf that falleth from a tree. I am a giant. For Jack, inspiration is real. The 19 senses and the 27 others flooded with the presence of muscles, hormones, neurons, blood, the momentary soul, and the inspired imagination. The Scottish poet referred to and quoted from is Hugh MacDiarmid, one of Michael's favorites, and the German is from Goethe, to live resolutely in the whole, the good, the true. Remembering that Mickey is a nickname for Michael, I answered, "To the mouse, dear Mickey. Your ears resemble those ancient movie cameras. I see you on that screen where shadows play in huge resemblances. Consciousness opens in a flash of light. Free basing love shines out. No one tells or has a better tale than you. Say cheese and open. Poetry. Wham." Free base equals cocaine that has been purified by heat with ether. So the mick with love, not drugs. Ether, the clear sky, the upper regions of air beyond the clouds, but not ether ore, is the mix element. He is mick unmixed. Pure poet. And this little song is from Michael. So much of the music of the dead, so many songs, so many poems, so many melodies crowd into my aging consciousness. So much of what remains, the sounds of men and women who walk the earth with steady gait at one time or another, and sang, and thought, yes, this will do. This will impress itself upon the will of the living, even after I am dust. For so much of the music of the dead was in them too, working upon them, telling them the story of life eternal. Books are not absolutely dead things, wrote Milton, but do contain a potency of life in them, which is a fiction, a fairy tale, a lie, but not entirely. There are dreams and the music of dreams, music the dead made into lasting sound that does not stop and tells me, listen. This is Jack Foley. Into lasting sound that does not stop and tells me, listen. This is Jack Foley.
If you vote in California and you are trying to sort out everything below the presidential line, we are here to help. We're doing debates on the big ballot initiatives.
When you look at every other place in the country, all we want to do is just put ourselves on par with how they tax large commercial property.
The property tax increase will mean skyrocketing rent for many small business owners.
Candidate interviews for state house races.
I've had 42 bills signed into law.
I'm proud to be an open democratic socialist.
And special reports on money in local politics. Tune in to Upfront starting at 7 a.m. If you want to browse through our coverage race by race, you can get all our election segments in a podcast feed. Just go to kpfa.org and look for California Ballot Breakdown. And remember, in California, your vote matters even more down the ballot.
Happy ending, nice and tidy. It's a rule I learned in school. Get your money every Friday. Happy endings are the rule. So divide up those in darkness from the ones who walk in light. Light 'em up, boys. There's your picture. Drop the shadows out of sight.
This is Jennifer Stone with Stone's Throw. These are the times that try men's souls. Tragic times. Too many people have died. Joe Biden said it. He said, it didn't have to be this bad. The only words I found are Shakespeare's words. He wrote, dry sorrow drinks our blood. Every third Tuesday of every month, I come on these airwaves and try to get to the bottom of things. This time, we're at the bottom of a very deep well, yes. You think you've hit bottom? Oh, no, there's a bottom below. There's a low below the low you know. You think you've hit bottom. Oh, no. Now, let's not have any of that negativity, Jennifer. Not allowed this season. Save it for later. First, all the good news. The good news is that the pandemic is not as bad as some people thought it might be. You know, how shall we measure progress in the 21st century? How did we measure progress during the AIDS epidemic? Ah, yes. People stopped dying. Well, yes. I look at the world and I say to myself, more eat than starve, right? Ha, yes. How will we go forward in 2020, this century? I wish I could say I'll be here to see it, but I guess I'll have to wait until I hear later, you know. They all say, shall we not grieve as the night comes on? Damn coronavirus. So many thousands gone, tens of thousands, and the sorrow of those families. The rest of the world forgets very soon, many thousands, hundreds of thousands. In the middle of this, we lost our giant freedom fighters, two of them. There was mourning there, indeed. Attention was paid, special honors, reverence for John Lewis and Ruth Bader Ginsburg. John Lewis is the last of the Moses generation. He walked with Martin Luther King. He brought us forth from Jim Crow, from that darkness. to the promised land. At least, yes, at least a step or two towards the promised land. What was it, 40 years in the wilderness? I think that's where Moses was for 40 years, but he didn't make it to the promised land. I hope that John Lewis feels that he did. He hung in there. With Martin Luther King, he stood there under the Washington Monument. They all made speeches. John Lewis, after all that excitement, he spent the rest of his life just working away day after day in Congress till the moment he died, a great black man and a great white woman. To hell with categories. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, she struggled, that white woman, that fight woman. She tried to lift women's civil rights, lift them up to an egalitarian level. Oh, mommy, can you paradigm, we used to say. Make a change. Make a change for women. Ruth Bader Ginsburg struggled to stay alive, just to stay alive a little longer, so that her seat on the Supreme Court would not be lost lost to a conservative judge, which, of course, that has happened. She tried so hard. She was fighting cancer, but the seat will apparently not be filled by a liberal justice. The presidential election will decide these matters, sadly. Ruth didn't live to see it. This judge, Amy Coney Barrett, the current nominee, she's a clear and present danger, certainly a danger to Roe versus Wade. If she is confirmed and given that seat on the high court, the highest court in the land, that woman could live half a century longer. Her presence may not just be the end of the left wing's, the left wing's weight on the court. It might just give the right wing their majority vote, 5-4. But she'll certainly be a gatekeeper. She will prevent so many cases from even reaching the high court. Let those two great patriots rest, and be remembered. Democracy survives through those great ones, but I feel the grief of the thousands. Yes, all these families who's dead, you know, dead are fallen because a careless ruler made absolutely no effort to save them. My God. I see some of the faces paraded on television. You see them weeping for their relatives. I guess I'm wondering how we are to learn to live with this new world. I tried to write a little story about a friend of mine with tuberculosis and how we lived with the threat of infection all those years back in the 1940s. But it isn't quite the same, not the same at all. I remember our dear friend, Carol. Carol was a patient of my father's. He had a sanitarium out there in Tucson, in the desert, you know, back in those days in Arizona, long before antibiotics. Those didn't come along until World War II. Now, tuberculosis was one of those diseases that people brought to the desert back in the day because they didn't have anything else to try to make things better. Now, Carol was mostly a special friend of my older sister. The rules in those days were very practical. No sleepovers. We tried very hard to watch how we shared food and even eating utensils. Carol had to live at home. She couldn't go to school. She had a bird aviary in her backyard. She made a life for herself at home. She had all small birds, so many tiny little birds to care for. She said she was happiest there at home. She did try once to go to school, but she couldn't share anything there. The isolation among so many. I just remember how happy we were rolling down the little awnings on the bird aviary and spraying them with the hose and everybody getting cooled off. Yes, my father said it was Victorian invalidism. I romanticized, you know, I thought she was a poet. Now, this coronavirus is not going to be like that, no. I don't know what it's going to be like. We don't know yet. We had to learn so much. That learning curve with AIDS, I had so much difficulty with that myself. I didn't know how that should be handled. I remember polio. I remember shutting down all the swimming pools and how people resisted that. And my father said, no, if it saves one life, shut the pools down. Take care of each other. Now, you can't count on politicians to do that. The scientists may help. They might be able to give us a daily update. They're doing that in Iceland. That's my favorite model. They have a panel of health experts and doctors on the screen right there. It's available. We've all got a television. Just to keep people up to the mark. Tell them what is really important to do. Surely we can take care of ourselves up to a point. Just use our heads. What the government can do, the president, the the people in Washington, what they can do is to make our lives livable. Nancy Pelosi is trying to get things squared away. People must have their medical needs met. I always say, just charge it. Send the bill to the U.S. Treasury. Let the Treasury Department print money. There you go. I always thought that that was the solution. Now, seriously, can't the Health and Welfare Department set up a kind of a public fund, you know, IOU, something like that, so that people aren't worried to death? And unemployment, yes, got to be okay. 25% unemployed during the Great Depression. Uh-huh. I don't know. We thought that Franklin Delano Roosevelt would save us, and he certainly tried. Yes, welfare. I just keep thinking we could give people little credit cards, the way they give them cards for for food stamps, and then they just put it all on the charge account until things get better and they've got a job or they have the health care they need. Now, I know that the bill will run up sky high. But we all know that this is not really a problem. This is never a problem. I think most of us just want to escape the realities of this hideous pandemic. I find myself digging into literary stories. I think, you know, the only thing that matters is keeping people well and trying to see this thing as part of history. Yes, history happens, I keep saying to myself. Ah, yes. My first exposure to literary portraits of plagues, I found it in a book called Forever Amber by Kathleen Windsor. Forever Amber, England in 1670 or so. I read that when I was about 12 years old. It scared me to death. The most literary, the most respectable description is in a book, a trilogy by Sigrid Undset, the great Scandinavian writer. She won a Nobel Prize for literature back in the day for Kirsten Lovren's Daughter. That was a masterpiece. It was pretty much the whole notion that Kirsten, that is Kirsten Lovren's daughter, the hero of this book, back in the 15th century Scandinavia, Sigrid Undset makes a portrait of this mother of seven sons. At the end, she evolves and she goes into a retreat. She finds her way into I guess a convent of sorts. It's all for victims of bubonic plague, and we come to understand that, of course, she will die in this retreat, giving her life for her for her sins a bit. Her dedication to the dying is her gift to the world. Now, I think to myself, is the author, Sigrid Undset, converted to Catholicism later in life? Ah, yes, literature and life. Our problems are going to be entirely different. That kind of sacrifice is just not appropriate anymore. I think we can learn to live with this virus and we can still have creative lives. Anybody want to go dancing? I just don't want us to have a civil war. Civil war, folks. I want you to go and get your New Yorkers, especially if you're a teacher or, you know, you have a classroom and, you know, virtual learning. Tell your kids to find the talk of the town in the New Yorkers. It's the best breakdown of what happens or is happening in this year's traumatic election. Let's see, the best breakdown is in the October 5th issue. It is first of all commentary written by all the editors of the New Yorker. It's an outline for a Biden presidency. And we all know that David Remnick, the editor of the New Yorker, he always says, there is no pain. We will not publish. Indeed. The editors draw up, sum up what has happened during the 4 years that we have all endured. And then it goes one editor at a time over the list of our problems, beginning with, right, a nation's health care rescuing the system. Then the climate crisis, that's the next piece. Rising to an emergency. Then the next piece is, the rule of law protecting the vote. That is the hardest one. How painful to think that all those Jim Crow problems come back again. telling people to count the beans in the jar before they can vote. Anyway, civil rights is the next issue, making equality real. This is the problem we have with it's the Black Lives Matter movement that has to be brought to the fore. We're finally able to deal with that. I always wring my hands and think, didn't we do that back in 68, 69? Didn't I see all my kids running around with these signs saying, black is beautiful? How come all these decades later we have to do it again? Oh, well. The last issue here is the longest one. It's on foreign policy. Restoring moral leadership. Give me a break. I can't believe it. It's so embarrassing. I know so many Americans who say they just don't go abroad right now. People ask them, what the hell is going on? God, I wish we knew. I think the trouble is too many people, well, I don't say they've given up, but we have all of these people breaking their necks and, literally dying for the cause. And then we find that there's this huge soup of what Hillary Clinton called the deplorables. They're right out in the middle of that. Think of them as the middle of the nation. They're sinking, yes, they're deplorables, spoiling the soup. I'm looking here at the other issue, the current issue of the New Yorker, October 19th. Remember, this is the talk of the town. When I was a school teacher, I used to just steal this stuff. I'd just, make copies and pass it out and say, this is your homework. Read this or that journalist or writer. And nobody ever sued me. I think it's a good idea. But the October 19th issue has a little picture of Donald Trump tossing his mask over his shoulder, who needs it? Who needs it? Now, the president, in an interview with Bob Woodward, acknowledged that the virus might be serious, but then he said, well, this is a quote, I think that goes away in 2 months with the heat, end quote. Now, on February the 24th of this year, as the infections in America increased, the president tweeted, quote, the coronavirus is very much under control in the USA. Later, he was quoted in Bob Woodward's book, Rage, and told Bob Woodward, he said, I wanted to always play it down. We can only imagine what he's thinking. I don't know. I think that this 8-month arc of our national crisis should teach us that it's probably better to deal with reality. Have yourself a good reality sandwich and take it from there. After he had a positive diagnosis, the president got well, he got better, and then he came out and he said, maybe I'm immune. That's a quote. And of course, he came up with a lot of other dangerous lies. He said that for most people, the coronavirus is, quote, far less lethal, unquote, than the seasonal flu. Scientists report that the coronavirus is about 6 times more deadly than the typical flu virus. Nancy Pelosi says of the president, she said, he's in denial as he was right from the start, unquote. Right. Nancy Pelosi trying to negotiate with Trump over a new economic stimulus package, you know. Seems to be, what is it, this constant push-pull. It's like, yes, we used to do that with a rope, you know, and one person fall down, another person fall down. You know, these rope pulls, anyway. Nancy Pelosi is quoted in the New Yorker. She says here, I could never explain to you any rational linear path of action on the part of the president. Gotcha. Right. I don't know. The bit in the New Yorker, the New Yorker tries to sum things up, you know, this. But they said that the Trump shocks are, what is that? They call it an operatic denouement here at the end. He's being, he's campaigning, actually, for his second term. And it has been staggering. Both the First Lady and the President have had a go with this virus, but they both hung out without their masks, and some three dozen White House employees, advisors, and recent guests have tested positive. Now, these sickened aides, the ones that were tested positive, they include a military officer who followed Trump around with that football, in quotes, that football that contains the codes that would enable him, the president, to launch a nuclear attack. This guy following Trump around, holding that football, you remember? There's a movie with Peter Sellers. I can't believe nonsense that Trump, I don't know. It's funny, he made this appearance with the Secret Service guys, you know, and he pulled it off. He gave the great wave, and down he went. Everybody was supposed to bow before the emperor. I don't know what actually happened at the end of that appearance in front of the White House, but it did look a little bit like the fall of Rome. I'll be back again one of these Tuesdays. Until then, go easy. And if you can't go easy, go as easy as you can.
Happy ending, nice and tidy. It's a rule I learned in school. Get your money every Friday. Happy endings are the rule. So divide up those in darkness from the ones who walk in light. Light 'em up, boys. There's your picture. Drop the shadows out of sight.
For several decades, Chris Hedges has maintained a penetrating, unblinking watch over our eroding nation. His grim reports have usually proven prophetic. Now, November 10th, just 1 week after this fateful election day, Hedges will express his outlook in a talk titled The Culture of Despair. With him will be Mickey Huff of Project Censored. KPFA's co-sponsor for this Zoom webinar. You can find the link on the KPFA website under events. That's November 10th for Pulitzer Prize journalist and trenchant observer Chris Hedges.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.